If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Proverbs, Proverbs chapter 1. Our text will be taken from verse 22, 29, and 30. And as we've noted thus far in our series of lessons on the Proverbs, the book itself deals with practical everyday living. It is a how-to-live manual, but also a how-not-to-live manual as well. But above all, it deals with God, His character, His work, and His blessings. And it tells us how we can live in close relationship to Him. But it is also a book of contrast and it contrasts the wise and the foolish, the man of God and the man in sin. And these are contrasted in dozens of situations throughout the book, in attributes, areas of conduct, speech, thought, the consequences of life, and ultimately the eternal destiny of each individual. And as we've noted, there are two key themes in the book of Proverbs. Wisdom, that true wisdom, which is from above, as James talks about in James chapter 3. And the second key theme is the lesson we discussed last week, the fear of Jehovah, the fear of God. And it leads us to respect His will and to obey His will. And certainly, as we talked about last week, it is the foundation for our relationship with God. And without it, we cannot enjoy a proper relationship with God because we won't have the proper respect, the reverence for Him. But yet also note what the fear of God is as well from this verse. It's the beginning of knowledge. And we understand that knowledge is essential in order to please God and ultimately to be saved from sin, because Christianity is a taught religion. And we must learn of God in order to come to faith in Him. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. But so too is wisdom essential, because wisdom is that which enables us to properly apply that which we know. In this context, the truth of God's Word. And as it were, Proverbs 23:23 serves as a crucial text to buy the truth and to sell it not. Also wisdom and instruction in understanding. And so in order to buy the truth, we have to have a desire to learn it and to come to knowledge of it. And so when we buy it, we are obeying it. We also buy as well instruction, understanding, and wisdom. Sadly, however, far too many refuse to buy the truth, or in some cases have bought the truth, but have sold it once more. Why? Because they don't want to pay the price involved. They do not want to gain the knowledge necessary in order to reap the benefits it has to offer. They don't want to listen to the voice of truth and consequently wisdom. And as such, Solomon describes such individuals in our lesson text as those who hate knowledge. And it is this problem we turn our attention to in this lesson. And so we are going to look at this tragic matter of hating knowledge in 2 points. First of all, we're going to look at the characteristics of those, how God describes those who hate knowledge, and the consequences that result when we hate true knowledge, knowledge of God. Our study this morning should impress upon you and I the importance of a knowledge of the truth of God's Word as it relates to our relationship with Him through being delivered by His power from the bondage of sin, and thus motivate us to buy the truth and to keep it in our lives at all times. First of all, as you look on the screen, first of all, let's look at those characteristics of those who hate knowledge. How does God describe these individuals? Well, number one, they are described as being simple. That is, they're not stupid, but they just do not know. It describes those who are naive or gullible. And it's descriptive of one who lacks judgment in common sense matters. And according to Proverbs chapter 7 and verse number 7. Further, it describes those who are willing to believe anything and everything. In other words, it describes those, you could tell them the sky is falling and they believe it. Most importantly, though, more seriously, it describes those who in religious matters are willing to take anything at face value, willing to take anything at truth. And we're going to develop this thought further. But further, these individuals stumble through life without giving consideration to their actions and ultimately to their consequences. It's like, it is as if they live without a care in the world. One with such a disposition loves simplicity, according to Proverbs 1, verse number 22. In fact, Solomon asks, "How long, ye simple ones, will ye love simplicity?" We might illustrate it this way. These individuals are like the high school student. And you remember being in high school? Remember being a teenager? Oh, that's the age you thought you knew it all. You were on top of the world. You were young, and your parents were old. They were over the hill. They really didn't know anything. And so as such, it's like one who laughs under their breath at their parents' advice from the Scripture. They're convinced they have a better take on things than their parents. Well, I know more than you do, Mom and Dad, so I'm going to do things your way. I'm young, you're not, so I've got a better handle on things. They think they know it all, and they think they know things better than God Himself and His Word. Now, as we think about it, as it relates to religious matters, sadly, as we all know, there are those who have the mindset today of, "Oh, I'll just take my preacher's word for it." Well, why not investigate the Scriptures for yourself? Well, I don't need to. My preacher knows everything, so I'll take his word for it. He can't steer me wrong. Oh, yes, he can. The preacher is not the authority. God is the authority. Think about the noble Bereans of old in Acts 17. They were taught by an inspired apostle. They were taught by the apostle Paul. But yet they didn't take Paul's word for it. They wanted to know more for themselves. They investigated. They searched the Scriptures daily to make sure that what they were taught was the truth. They were not content to just take Paul's word for the matter. And I encourage you this morning, don't be content to take my word for the matter. Back up what I am saying with the Scriptures. Make sure that what I am teaching you is God's word, is the truth. Book, chapter, and verse. But those who would rather take the preacher's word for matters and not be like the noble Bereans would be described as simple by God Himself. But then secondly, they are described by God as being foolish. Again, you look at Proverbs 1, verse number 22, as you can see on the screen. Those who do not like knowledge are fools. Fools hate knowledge. And it's the idea of one who clings to foolishness. One who is not willing to listen to God's word is clinging to foolishness because they despise wisdom. They despise instruction. They think they know it all. They think they have it all figured out for themselves. They hate true knowledge, and they have no desire for it. And as such, they ignore, they disregard the pursuit of wisdom, according to Proverbs chapter 17, in verse number 24. We're told that wisdom is before him that hath understanding, but the eyes of a fool are in the ends of the earth. They're everywhere else but in the pursuit of this true, genuine wisdom, this heavenly, this divine wisdom which is from above, which is available to all. They're not concerned about it. Such a one can get to the point of being without reason, yet they insist on speaking, according to Proverbs verse chapter 17 and verse number 7. Excellent speech becomes not a fool, much less do lying lips a prince. And certainly this would describe those in the religious world, those preachers who think they know things, but they have a grasp on things, but in reality, they don't. But then number 30, you have the mocker, the scoffer. It's one who displays open contempt, who doesn't hide behind their contempt. They openly display their contempt for wisdom, for instruction. And according to Proverbs 11, verse 9, it describes those who bring strife. And certainly those who are mockers, who are scoffers, bring strife. Think about those today in our society who try to deny the existence of God, who try, who try to stamp out every vestige of God in the Bible in society. Would this not describe those they're seeking to produce strife among others? They don't want to listen to God. They don't want to acknowledge God's existence. And certainly it describes those in the days of Peter there in 2 Peter chapter 3 who scoffed at the coming of Christ. If he said he's coming again, why hasn't he already come? They laugh at his promises. They mock the promises of God. They scoff at them. And as a result, they are walking after their own lusts. They're walking by sight. They're walking by their own feelings, by their own ideas, rather than turning to God and trusting Him and walking by faith. And you'll note that these characteristics grow progressively worse. Then you have the brutish or the irrational. Look at Proverbs 12 and verse number 1. We're told here in Proverbs 12 and verse number 1 that whoso loves instruction, notice this, whoso loveth, and again that's present active, you continue to love instruction, loveth knowledge, and again that's continuous action per the King James Version. But he that hateth reproof or correction or discipline is brutish or irrational. They are so opposed to such instruction, they are unwilling to accept correction in the form of reproof. And reproof is designed to prevent one from continuing down the wrong course. You know, we reprove our children when they misbehave. Why do we do it? Why do we discipline them? So that they can change course, so that they can change behavior. Why does God reprove us? So that we do not continue in the same line of behavior. That's why when we preach God's word, we are to rebuke and reprove with all long-suffering and doctrine. But yet such an individual who hates knowledge is described as being brutish, like a mindless animal. And they are irrational. They have no concern for their spiritual welfare or the concern others may have for them. Their mindset is, well, I don't need God. I don't need the Bible. So you can take God. You can take the Bible and go somewhere else with it because I have no need for it. That's the mindset of these individuals. And it's heartbreaking, is it not? When people say, I don't need God. I don't need the Bible. And we're going to further show this in our next point. Above all, though, they are unrighteous. Again, you look at Proverbs 12 and verse 2 and 3. A good man obtains favor of the Lord, but a man of wicked devices will he condemn. A man shall not be established by wickedness, but the root of the righteous shall not be moved. You see, in order to be accepted by God and obtain His favor, we must practice righteousness, according to Acts 10:35. We must be a doer of righteousness. How do we do that? Well, it's revealed through the gospel, Romans 1, 16 and 17. However, those who hate knowledge, they are unrighteous because of their unwillingness to receive instruction and knowledge and to apply it. They're not going to be successful in their doings. Well, why is that? Because we're told in verse number 3 here, a man is not established by wickedness, but by righteousness. And this holds true for a nation. This holds true for any society of people, not just individuals. Because Solomon's going to come over to in Proverbs chapter 14 and tell us that it is righteousness that exalts a nation. But sin is a reproach to any people. Why is our nation in the shape it is in? Because, as Brother Ricky has pointed out, and as several of you have pointed out time and again in our classes, it's because we have turned away from God. We have turned away from His Word. Could we not say that our nation is a reproach at this juncture because of its situation? Our duty as Christians is to call men back to God. To call men to God. To call men to change their lives. To submit their lives to the righteousness of God. And we do that through our proclamation of the gospel. We call all men everywhere to study the scriptures for themselves, to investigate for themselves, so that they can come to knowledge of the truth. God would have all men to be saved. That's God's desire, is for all men to be saved and come to knowledge of the truth. And the truth is that which makes us free. And Christ said we can know it. We just have to have that willingness to accept what the truth is. We just have to have that honest and good heart that is receptive. But yet, let's not be mistaken. Even as Christians, our hearts can be closed to the truth in time. Why do Christians fall away? Because we stop listening to God. Why do we become unfaithful? Because we stop listening to God. We close this book. We close the book. We don't study it. We allow the book, God's book, to gather dust. And thus we cease growing in knowledge and in grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And when we stop growing, our faith stops growing. Our faith grows weak, and ultimately our faith dies. And when our faith dies, our relationship with God is dead as well. So we need to love. We need to cherish knowledge. We need to hunger and thirst after righteousness. Hunger and thirst. Feed on God's word. Because if we don't, the consequences are going to be terrible. Hence, let's consider the consequences at this time. Number one, if we reject knowledge, we reject God, because we're not going to have a fear of God. Again, look at Proverbs 1, verse 29. For they that hated knowledge, those that hate knowledge, do not choose the fear of the Lord. Notice this. We choose to fear God or not. No one forces us to fear Him. And this expands on what we talked about last Sunday morning. We make the choice whether or not we're going to fear God. Without fear of God, though, we cannot begin to know that which we must know in order to be saved. We must have that willingness to hear. Those who hate knowledge refuse to listen to God. And that refusal is based on their refusal to respect Him, to reverence Him. By their actions, such individuals are saying, well, I don't need God. I can do things my own way, as Frank Sinatra once sang. And by their actions, they are saying in their hearts, well, there's no God. And as such, are demonstrating practical atheism in their lives, if not outright practicing it. So if we choose to reject knowledge of God, we choose to reject God Himself in fear of Him. Number two, obviously, it's a refusal to listen to instruction. It is through that instruction, the instruction through God's Word, that we gain this knowledge of God's truth. We gain the knowledge not just necessary to become a Christian, but also to live as a Christian. Think about it. How can we live a life of holiness unto God? How can we be holy as God is holy if we do not know what it means to be holy? Well, we can't. In order for me to become holy, I need to investigate the scriptures. I need to study. I need to open the book. I need to listen to God. And He'll explain to me what it means to live a holy life. He'll explain to me what it means to bear the proper fruit in my life as a Christian. He'll explain to me through His Word what it means to add to my faith. He'll explain to me what it means to conform my life to the image of His dear Son. He'll explain to me those things that I need to avoid in my life, so that I can live a life that is pleasing unto Him. Knowledge indeed is power when it is properly used and applied. But a lack thereof, as we'll see here in just a moment, is deadly to the soul. But closely connected, it's a refusal to listen to wisdom. It's a refusal to accept and to gain wisdom. You think about this. Think about how wisdom is personified here in Proverbs, the book of Proverbs, as a woman that cries out. Notice in verse 20 of Proverbs 1, wisdom crieth without. Notice verse 21, in the chief place of concourse, in the opening of the gates, in the city. in the streets. Wisdom has made her voice known. She is available. She is not just holed up somewhere. Wisdom is crying out to us now. So all can receive wisdom. All can receive the instruction of wisdom if they're willing to listen. It is those who despise knowledge that close their ears to the cries of wisdom. They shut their ears, saying, I don't want to hear it. I don't need it. And as such, they are foolish because they despise wisdom. They despise instruction. They refuse to listen to wisdom's call, verse 24. In fact, they refuse to take her outstretched hand to receive the blessings, the benefits she has to offer. And think about it. Wisdom's hand is outstretched. It's available to us all. But we have to accept it. We have to take that outstretched hand. Ultimately, as a result of hating knowledge, it's not going to enable us to be able to discern between good and evil, right and wrong, and truth and error. How can we know what is true and what is a lie? Well, we have to study. We have to know these things. We are told in 1 John 4, verse 1, to try the spirits to see if they are of God or not. Why have so many people been led astray? Because they do not have a knowledge of God. Because they are unable to discern between that which is good and that which is evil. That's why our society is in the shape it is in. People are starting to call good evil and evil good. You think about how homosexuality is viewed in our society. When y'all were growing up, things such as that would be viewed as abominable, would they not? But now, it's normal and acceptable. Sin is viewed as normal and acceptable. I think that's one reason why so many do not obey the gospel, is because they do not have a proper recognition of sin. And that's where we failed in the Lord's church, is failing to convict people of sin, failing to preach on the true nature and the horrible nature of sin. And we need to do that. And we must do that so that people can come to recognize sin for what it is and do something about it before it is everlasting too late. Obviously, those who hate knowledge hate reproof and they hate correction. And as a result, their behavior is irrational. It's little wonder then that we see that in Proverbs chapter 12 and verse number 1. And we've talked about that somewhat in depth, so we won't spend much time there. But then, when we choose to reject knowledge of God, it just leads us to becoming wise in our own eyes. In Proverbs 3, verse number 7, we're told, be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord. Again, there's the phrase, fear the Lord. And depart from evil. What keeps us from becoming wise in our own eyes? Fearing Jehovah God. But what happens if we don't? Well, we're not going to depart from evil because we're going to become wise in our own eyes. Those wise in their own eyes refuse to heed the warnings given by Solomon here as well as throughout the rest of the Bible. And they are described thusly in Proverbs 12, verse 15, that the way of a fool is right in his own eyes. And why are they called foolish? Because God has already said, it's not a man that walketh to direct his own steps. And God would go on to say through Solomon in Proverbs 14 that there is a way that seems right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. You see, what man may think to be right isn't always right. That's why we need to be governed by God, governed by His Word. And we do that when we study His Word and we apply it. And as a result, if we're wise in our own eyes, if we hate all of these things, we're going to be described as those who are ever learning and never able to come to knowledge of the truth. In 2 Timothy 3, verse 7, some were like that in the days of Paul. It isn't that people are not knowledgeable. So many people are very knowledgeable. That is, they have a vast amount of earthly knowledge. The problem is they reject knowledge of those things which are of eternal importance. They reject knowledge of God. They reject knowledge of His Word. They have no concern for it. Sadly, why is there so much religious division? Because so many are blinded to the reality that what they believe is not truth. They may say they study the Bible, but in their study, their minds are so closed because of their own prejudices, because of their own preconceived notions, especially as it relates to baptism. You ever know any people who've cut out passages from their Bible? Went to a Bible study once several years ago. And I think now this was before Susan and I even met. I was involved in a Bible study. Was going to talk to the man about baptism. And I mentioned Acts 2:38 and he said, "What?" I said, "Acts 2:38." And he said, "That's not in my Bible." And I said, "How can that not be in your Bible? Because there Peter said, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." And I asked him, "How can that not be in your Bible?" He said, "It's not in my Bible because I cut it out of my Bible." And then he proceeded to turn in his Bible, and he showed me right there in the text was a big old hole where he had cut it out. And I asked him, "Well, why did you cut Acts 2:38 out of your Bible?" And he said, "I just didn't like what it had to say." To that I asked, "You're going to cut out Mark 16:16, Romans 6:3 and 4, Galatians 3:27, Acts 22:16, 1 Peter 3:21. He said, "I've marked those out." And he went through to show me that he'd taken a marker and marked through those passages. Was he a smart man? Yes. But was he willing to come to knowledge of the truth? No, and that's the problem we are dealing with. That's the problem we are addressing. Notice this. If you're not going to be able to come to knowledge of the truth, you're going to self-destruct. Again, that passage again, Brother Ricky, of Hosea 4, verse 6. Destroyed for a lack of knowledge. We are responsible. We are responsible for whether we come to know God or not. Think about Revelation 3, verse 20. In rebuking the church at Laodicea, Christ also said here, he pleads with them to repent. And he says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me." You know, I found an interesting analogy of this. There was an artist by the name of Holman Hunt who painted a picture of this very passage some years back, in which Jesus is standing at the door knocking. Now, Hunt was criticized for his painting, because in the painting, Hunt had Jesus knocking at the door, but what they criticized him for was not having a door handle on the outside of the door. But Hunt responded to his criticism. Hunt replied, "If the door of the human heart is to be opened, it will be man opening it from the inside." And that's the point of Revelation 3:20. Christ says, if you open up the door, who has to open the door? I have to open the door to my heart. See, God's not going to knock the door down. God's not going to force His way in. We have to hear and open the door ourselves. We must choose to open the door. We must choose to open the door to the call of wisdom, instruction, and knowledge. You see, if we don't, this is the end result. We'll lose our soul. We cannot save our soul. What shall a man give in exchange for his soul? What shall a man be profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? And the answer is nothing. This is the ultimate and eternal consequence of hating knowledge, of rejecting God's Word, of rejecting truth. Proverbs 12, verse 1 teaches us the kind of people we ought always to be, those who love instruction and thus love knowledge. If we truly love such, we will indeed love our souls, because we will receive and apply the instruction and knowledge of God's Word that will enable us to be saved and to say saved. In Proverbs 12, verse 28, if we apply this to our lives, if we apply God's word to our lives, the end result is this. In the way of righteousness is life, and in the pathway thereof is death. We're going to be walking in the way of righteousness. We're going to be walking the straight and narrow way, in which there is life and no death. Consequently, though, if we despise knowledge, the opposite will be true. We will find ourselves in the pathway of unrighteousness, in the broad way, in which there is no life and only death. Let us be wise this morning. Let us choose to love instruction and knowledge and listen to God. Listen to the voice of wisdom. And if you're here this morning and you're not listening to God, you can listen to Him this morning. If you've never obeyed the gospel, we encourage you to do that now. As a Christian, though, if you have strayed away, be wise. Listen to God's call for you to come back home in repentance, confession of sin, and prayer to God for forgiveness. And your soul will benefit eternally. If you're here this morning, you're subject to heaven's invitation. Please come right now as together we stand, as we sing.